Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Bryan Lynn tells us why people in China are needing to work later in life. Anna Matteo presents this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. She looks at new research on the risks of drinking alcohol. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
China's economic expansion has been driven partly by millions of people who left their rural homes to work in cities and factories. But many of these workers are aging, and they are finding it difficult to retire in their home communities because government assistance can be low. This issue is linked to the way China's social security system works. People living in Chinese cities earn higher retirement payments than those living in rural areas. People who choose to go to the city to work are known as rural migrants. Reporters from Reuters recently explored retirement or pension payments in China. The news agency spoke with rural migrant workers, researchers, economists, and a government advisor. Reuters reported that about 100 million rural migrants will near retirement age over the next 10 years. If these people decide to retire and return to their homes, they could earn as little as $17 per month. The World Bank defines extreme poverty as living on less than $2.15 per day. One example is 67-year-old Hu Dexi. He and his wife sold homemade rolls for 30 years on the streets in the city of Xiang. Hu told Reuters he is ready to retire, but he said he and his wife are still working to earn the amount of money they say they need. The couple now lives outside of Beijing, where they both work as cleaners in a shopping center, earning $552 each a month. "No one can look after us," Hu told Reuters. He explained that he does not think entering retirement is possible at the moment. "I don't want to be a burden on my two children, and our country isn't giving us a penny." Many rural migrants in China face similar situations. They do not have the skills for high-paying jobs and often cannot depend on children for support. China has aimed to increase economic growth and productivity with continued industrial expansion. But critics argue that such a system often does not serve retirees well. In addition, China's social security system is not prepared for the large number of people nearing retirement age. The Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, CASS, has estimated the nation's pension system could completely run out of money by 2035. CASS also estimated the level of health care assistance to city workers was in some cases about four times greater than for those in rural areas. A recent news article appearing in the Chinese Cadre Tribune, a Communist Party publication, reported that more than 16% of rural people older than 60 were unhealthy. This compared to 10% in cities. Kai Fong, an economist for CASS and a former central bank advisor, wrote the story. China has introduced private retirement programs. It has also provided financial assistance to provinces that have pension budget deficits. Other countries have tried to build up pensions by increasing the retirement age. But China's is among the lowest in the world, age 60 for men and between 50 and 55 for women. Chinese officials have said the government plans to raise the retirement age, but has not said when that will happen. Official Chinese government records show about 94 million working people were older than 60 in 2022. This group represents about 13% of working people. It has increased from about 9% of working people in 2020. That share is currently lower than some other Asian countries, including Japan and South Korea. But it is set to rise sharply as 300 million more Chinese reach their 60s over the next 10 years. About one-third of those people are rural migrants, Reuters reports. I'm Bryan Lynn.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Alcohol is often consumed at social gatherings, from happy hours after work to birthday parties on the weekend. Drinking some alcohol is normal and believed to be good for heart health. However, new research may have put an end to that idea. Dr. Timothy Namy directs the Canadian Institute for Substance Use Research at the University of Victoria. He said drinking less is a great way to be healthier. Guidelines or advice for drinking alcohol differ greatly from country to country. But overall, the advice has been moving toward drinking less. Britain, France, Denmark, Holland, and Australia recently reviewed new evidence and lowered the suggested amount of alcohol consumption. Ireland went further than most. It will require cancer warning descriptions on alcohol starting in 2026. Karina Ferrari-Borges is an advisor for alcohol at the World Health Organization Office for Europe. She said scientists see evidence linking alcohol to over 200 health conditions, including cancers, cardiovascular diseases, and injuries. Overall, people may have already been moving toward drinking less alcohol. Social calendar events called Dry January and Sober October are celebrated with non-alcoholic drinks. Dry means no alcohol, and a sober person is not affected by alcohol. People my age are way more accepting of it, said Tessa Weber. The 28-year-old from Austin, Texas, said she stopped drinking for Dry January, after seeing how alcohol increased her anxiety. She liked the results. Better sleep, more energy, and has stuck with it. The idea that alcohol can be heart-friendly came from imperfect studies comparing groups of people by how much they drink. Usually, alcohol consumption was measured at one point in time, and none of them compare drinkers and non-drinkers. As a result, these studies could not prove cause and effect. People who report drinking an average amount of alcohol usually have higher income, education, and better health care. It turns out that when you adjust for those things, the benefits tend to disappear, Dr. Namy said. Most studies also did not include younger people, and almost half of the people who die from alcohol-related causes die before the age of 50. If you're studying people who survived into middle age, didn't quit drinking because of a problem, and didn't become a heavy drinker, that's a very select group, Namy said. It creates an appearance of a benefit for moderate drinkers. Other studies challenge the idea that alcohol has benefits. These studies compare people with a certain gene variant that makes it unpleasant to drink to people without this gene variant. People with this gene tend to drink very little or not at all. One of these studies found people with the gene variant have a lower risk of heart disease. This may supply more proof that alcohol does not protect people from heart problems. So how many alcoholic drinks can people safely have every day? That depends. Drinking alcohol raises the risk of several kinds of cancer, including colon, liver, breast, mouth, and throat. Alcohol breaks down in the body into a substance called acetaldehyde. This substance can damage your cells and stop them from repairing themselves. That creates the conditions for cancer to grow. Thousands of U.S. deaths per year could be prevented if people follow the U.S. government's guidelines. They advise men to limit themselves to 2 drinks or fewer per day, and women to 1 drink or fewer per day, Namy said. 1 drink is the equivalent of about 1 can of beer, a glass of wine, or a very small glass of hard alcohol. Namy served on an advisory committee. That committee wanted to lower the guideline for men to 1 drink per day. However, that advice was rejected when the federal guideline came out in 2020. The simple message that's best supported by the evidence is that if you drink, less is better when it comes to health, Namy said. On its website, the National Institutes of Health says some people should not consume alcohol at all. The agency says to avoid alcohol completely if you are taking medications that interact with alcohol, having a medical condition that can be made worse by drinking. Under the age of 21, the minimum legal drinking age in the U.S., recovering from alcohol use disorder, or unable to control the amount you drink, pregnant, or might become pregnant. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Matteo.
That was Ana Matteo with this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Ana is here now to talk more about the story. Hi, Ana. Good to speak with you.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
So, what has been a trend in alcohol consumption that you can tell us about?
More people celebrate alcohol-free calendar events like Dry January and Sober October. Also, bars and restaurants now offer more non-alcoholic drink choices.
And what does the word dry mean in this case?
Well, at a dry event, alcohol is not served. And if someone commits to Dry January, for example, they do not drink any alcohol for the whole month.
It used to be widely believed and even reported in the media that alcohol can be good for the heart. What is the thinking now?
Past studies on alcohol led to the misconception that alcohol is good for the heart. But researchers have gone over these studies and now consider them to be flawed.
Interesting. I guess it's a good thing I prefer non-alcoholic beer then.
Yes, it is. And there are many non-alcoholic beer options these days that are quite tasty. You know, I quit drinking alcohol back in 2019 after I interviewed a neuroscientist who told me of the dangers. So I decided to quit for a year, and I just never went back. My sleep, my energy, and my ability to focus all improved.
Thanks so much for your report today, Ana, and thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Ana. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Research has shown that a majority of American teachers report feeling stressed and unhappy at work. And a recent study by Brown University and the University of Albany found that reduced job happiness among teachers is linked to their sense of autonomy in their classroom. Teachers with autonomy are given the chance to make decisions and plans on their own. On tomorrow's Education Report, Dan Novak looks at one top-performing public school in the state of Florida that has chosen to give its teachers more autonomy. Listen tomorrow for that report.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In lessons 32 and 33 of the series, Anna has a new TV show for children. In the show, there is a computer named Mindy that helps Anna travel to different places. But Mindy sometimes has trouble sending Anna to the correct place.
Anna loves baseball, and she wants to travel to a ballpark to talk about the sport of baseball. But Mindy has sent Anna to wrong places, including the ocean. Let's see if Mindy can fix the problem.
Last time on the Time Traveling Treehouse, Anna was lost, really lost. She wants to learn about baseball, but her computer Mindy sent her to many wrong places.
Mindy, help me. I am in the ocean with a shark.
I will try one more time, Anna.
Please try harder, Mindy. Now where am I? I'm at a playground with a baseball field. Yes! I can teach children about baseball here.
Mindy! Mindy! It took you a long time, but you did it!
Thanks, Anna. Give me a call when you find the answer.
Okay.
Now Anna can explain how to play baseball, a sport that is popular in the United States.
To play baseball, you really only need a bat, a ball, and a glove. Each team has many players. Pitchers pitch the ball. Catchers catch the ball. Batters bat the ball. Runners run the bases. Fielders field the ball.
In baseball, bases are special places on the field. And to bat means to hit the ball with a specially shaped piece of wood or metal called a bat. To pitch means to throw the ball to the batter. The throw itself is called the pitch.
Have you noticed how the same word can work in different ways? The word bat can be either a verb or a noun. To bat means to hit, and a bat is the piece of wood or metal.
And the batter is the person who holds the bat and tries to bat the ball.
For some words in English, we can take the noun or verb form and add the ending er, pronounced er, to describe the person or agent doing the activity. Here are several examples.
Run, runner.
Work, worker.
Dance, dancer.
Swim, swimmer.
Think, thinker.
Bank, banker.
Pitch, pitcher.
In baseball, the pitcher is the person who throws the ball to the batter. To pitch is the verb, while the pitch is the noun, the name for the throw itself, from pitcher to batter.
When you are learning new words in English, it is helpful to know how the words can be used in different forms, like to pitch, the pitch, and pitcher.
Let's take another example using the verb create. To create means to make something new and original.
A creator is someone who creates, just like a pitcher is someone who pitches.
But here's where English spelling might drive you crazy. Words like pitcher, batter, runner, and dancer all end with the letters ER. But creator ends with the letters OR. But it still sounds like the sound ER, creator.
How else can the word create change? Well, we can use the noun form, creation, the adjective creative, or the adverb creatively.
To repeat the forms, that's create, creator, creation, creative, creatively.
So remember, when you learn a new word in English, be sure to check the dictionary to learn all the forms of the word.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the Learning English Podcast. Before we move on, we should say one more thing about baseball. We have many idiomatic expressions in English that come from the sport, such as hit a home run or be out in left field.
If you want to learn more about these, enter the following words in a search on the internet. Words and their stories, VOA, baseball.
Let's repeat that. The search terms are words and their stories, VOA, for Voice of America, and baseball. That will help you find a VOA Learning English article that explains all of the baseball expressions and gives more information about the sport.
After Anna's computer, Mindy, brought her back to the right place, Anna was able to finish teaching about baseball. And then she asks Mindy to return her to what she calls her treehouse, which in this scene is really a room at the office.
Mindy, Mindy, we found the answer. It's time to return to the treehouse.
Good job. That was fast.
The end.
Good job, Anna. You know, I still don't like children's shows. But I like this children's show.
In American culture, we often say positive, supportive things to people we work with. We call these statements compliments.
An easy compliment to say is, good job.
Good job. That was fast.
Good job, Anna.
Here are some other compliments we commonly say.
That was thoughtful of you. Thanks.
You are so helpful. I really appreciate it.
It's great having you on our team.
Way to go. Nice job.
I really like what you've done here, Andrew.
Well, thank you. Now, here's something our listeners can do. Try to compliment someone you know in English. Then, you can write to us and tell us about it at learningenglish@voanews.com.
And while Andrew and I don't need compliments, we do like to hear your comments and what you think about the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast.
Remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Dr. Jill.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.